Good morning, everyone. My name's Todd Pulsifer, and welcome to All Nations Church and All Nations Church Online. It's great to be with you today, and I get the pleasure of sharing God's Word with you this morning. And it's a special weekend here at ANC because it's our Bethlehem Live production that's happening at Ashfield Farm. So tonight will be the last time that you can see it. And you're able to book slots online to be able to come through our kind of live demonstration of what the birth of Jesus was like. And it's kind of a living message with real animals, actors. I'm going to be one of them. I'm a wise man this year, so it's going to take a lot of training. And I'm going to be totally faking my job. But it's going to be a lot of fun and a real creative way to share the Christmas story with people. There's a lot of work that goes into this, but you can see the benefit when you walk through it. So we want to make a big invite to you if you'd like to be a part of that here at Ashfield Farm. Again, tonight is the last opportunity to be able to be part of that. And we are really getting into the Christmas season, aren't we? The weather's starting to turn a little colder. We're doing things like Bethlehem Live. I'm sure that people are beginning to think about Christmas shopping, who they're going to spend the holidays with, where they're going to go, what they're going to eat, if they're going to get time off, all that kind of great thinking. We can't wait to get together with family over the holidays. And I just this morning wanted to bring you a quick encouragement as we kind of get closer to a time when people will take holidays and where life kind of changes gears a little bit, to make sure that you and I are dressed properly for the season. Some of you may be getting out your winter coats and winter boots, or getting the snowblower ready for coming storms that are going to happen probably soon. But I wonder whether we pay as much attention to the attitudes that we carry out life with, the hope that we have, or whether we just kind of rush through the season sort of really, really busy with all the tasks that can go along with the holidays. And I was thinking of this verse, and I want to encourage you with it this morning. It's found in the book of Romans, chapter 13, verse 14. And it says this, and I love the language that it uses here. It says, "But put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no plans to satisfy the fleshly desires." That's the Holman Christian Standard Version. Here's the Passion Translation. It says, "Instead, fully immerse yourselves into the Lord Jesus, the Anointed One, and don't waste even a moment's thought on your former identity to awaken its selfish desires." Now, if we want the magnified view of this one scripture, let's hear what the Message has to say. And it incorporates a couple of previous verses before verse 14, but it's really, 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 really good. Listen to what the Message says. It says, "But make sure that you don't get so absorbed and exhausted in taking care of all your day-to-day obligations that you lose track of the time and doze off, oblivious to God. The night is about over. The dawn is about to break. Be up and awake to what God is doing right now. God is putting the finishing touches on the salvation work He began when we first believed. We can't afford now to waste a minute. We must not squander these precious daylight hours in frivolity and indulgence, in sleeping around and dissipation, in bickering and grabbing for everything that we can find in sight. Get out of bed and get dressed. Don't loiter or linger, waiting until the very last minute. Dress yourselves in Christ and be up and about." And you know, even more so sometimes in the activities that we involve ourselves in, it's the attitude in which we engage in those activities that is so much more important. Do you know you can even make a difficult task or a mindless task entertaining or positive simply by the attitude in which you engage in that activity? And there are so many people we are going to meet family, but also people that you've probably never met before in a store, at a gas station, who knows where those meetings may happen. And when they do, we want to make sure that we're dressed properly, that people can see by the way we act and behave that we belong to the Lord Jesus Christ. Being a Christian, it does begin with a personal belief in the heart. But the evidence of our relationship with Jesus is just not all internal or hidden. You can see Jesus on the countenance of people's faces. You can see Jesus in the way they conduct their affairs, in the things that they say, in the things that they don't say, where they put themselves in a line, preferring one another. And this Christmas season, I want to make sure that whatever you're doing, you're wearing the right clothes to do it with. Not only is it going to benefit people around you, but it's going to benefit you to be able to do the tasks that are required of you during this time in a sense of joy and a sense of peace. And I think one of the ways we can do that is just by being mindful before we head into an activity, before we rush into it. And I know we can be pressed for time many times in between events or tasks that we have to do, but just simply stopping and saying, Lord, am I about to head into this activity with the leftovers of the last activity that was really frustrating? And I'm going to start something new, but not start it with a new attitude. And it's sometimes just as simple, you know, before you head out the door, before you go to the store to buy presents for people, before you do what's required of you, perhaps during this season, maybe you have to work, you're not going to have any time off, or as much time as you'd like to be able to have with family. And it's depressing. It's not what you'd like to be doing, but you know, you can do even things that you'd like not to be doing, but do it with a good attitude simply by stopping and remembering that Jesus Christ lives on the inside of you, and he wants to bear his fruit through your life, through the things you say, through the things you don't say, and by the way that you conduct yourselves. And if we've ever been in a time when people are looking for positive people to be around, people who have hope on the inside, people who aren't self-absorbed and just concerned about putting themselves as number one in every story and in every picture, it's now. You are going to run across those people. I'm going to run across those people. I want to make sure that they have an opportunity to come in contact with the Lord Jesus Christ through my life. I want to just read for us a few verses of Galatians chapter 5, where it talks about the difference between the flesh and the Holy Spirit who's come to live on the inside. And basically the nature of the flesh that it's talking about is that old selfish life where we thought we had to, you know, it was us first, or we weren't going to get dinner, or we weren't going to get lunch, and we would push our way to the supper table, or not just the supper table, but any area of life. It was an us first, self-centered type of living, where now that we have a relationship with Jesus and the Holy Spirit has come to live on the inside, we get to take a comfortable backseat, knowing that Jesus is now looking after us and our affairs. And we don't have to be so hands-on making sure that we're at the front of the line all the time. Listen to what Galatians chapter 5 says. In verse 16, it says, I say then, walk by the Spirit, and you will not carry out the desires of the flesh. That's that self-centeredness. For the flesh desires what is against the Spirit, and the Spirit desires what is against the flesh. These are opposed to each other, so that you don't do what you want. But if you are led by the Spirit, you're not under the law. And then it goes into some detail here. Paul gives us some detail as to what the flesh looks like and what the Holy Spirit looks like. The works of the flesh are obvious. This is verse 19. Sexual immorality, moral impurity, promiscuity, idolatry, sorcery, hatred, strife, jealousy, outbursts of anger, selfish ambition, dissensions and factions, envy, drunkenness, carousing, and all things that are similar to that. And I tell you, as I have about these things earlier, that no one who makes a lifestyle out of that type of behavior is going to inherit the kingdom of God. And then in verse 22, he says, but the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness and self-control. Against such there is no law. In other words, there's nothing prohibiting that kind of behavior that the Holy Spirit produces in the life of a believer. Now, those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. And since we live by the Spirit, we must also follow the Spirit. So it's a good reminder for us, especially when things get busy at this time of year, to just take a breath. Maybe even right now, you may be feeling the pressure mounting on your shoulders already. Just take a breath and just say to the Holy Spirit, I'm not the one who's in control here. You are in control, and I'm here to follow your lead. And Lord, above all the tasks I want to get accomplished, I want to do them well. I want to do them filled with the Holy Spirit, not only for my benefit, but for the people who are watching my life. There are people who are in way more difficult circumstances than I find myself in, and they may need hope. They may need to hear the gospel for the first time for me. And if I'm attentive only about myself and my needs, I'm not going to be interested in the needs of others. But the Holy Spirit frees us from that cycle and allows us to actually have the needs of other people foremost and first as we go about our daily business. Don't just be content to have a hidden belief about Jesus at any time of year, but especially this time of year, because there's going to be so many opportunities. Put Christ on the outside where people can see him through your actions. You know, we name trees, especially fruit trees, by the fruit that they produce. You know, if you're longing for an apple, you just don't go up to an apple tree and bite off a piece of the bark and, you know, suddenly get refreshed. You wait for fruit to form on that tree and you eat of the fruit. And you know, it's the same way with us, especially this time of year, being around so many people who may have varied needs and many, many who need Jesus Christ in their life. They're going to be attracted to him through the fruit he bears in us. They're going to look at the peace. They're going to look at the joy. They're going to look at the fact that we don't need to be at the center of everything. And they're going to be attracted to that. And then that's going to open up a door for you and I to share the gospel with them. You know, when I first became a Christian, and actually previous to becoming a Christian, I really thought that being a Christian was all about the rules I had to follow. This strict list of moral obligations that I had to fulfill for God to be pleased with me. And thank God, that's not actually the heart of being a Christian. It's actually Jesus coming to live on the inside of you and freeing you from needing to be at the center of everything. And him now co-laboring with you in a covenant of love, promising to not only be present there, but to look after you. In Matthew chapter 6, Jesus preached a great sermon talking to people, saying, you know, people who live without God are constantly concerned about all the details of life. What am I going to eat? What am I going to wear? Where am I going to go? Where am I going to go and get this special gift for my child that they want so badly? But Jesus said, if the life of knowing me is being able to set all that aside and let me be first, and all the cares of life will have a context and they will find a context around me. And I promise to meet every need that you have. That, and when I discovered that knowing Jesus was like that, it was like, oh gosh, am I ever glad to not have to be at the center of my life. But Jesus comes to be the center and the source of my life now. Man, life in a mall at Christmas time can get crazy. I remember way back in the 80s, and this is a bit old school, but there was a gift called a Cabbage Patch doll. I think they've probably made a couple of resurgence since. But man, if you could get your hands on one of these things, you were a hero. And lots of people who bought them then put them on various ways to sell them at an exorbitant price. But you can actually, I wouldn't necessarily encourage it, but there are actually fights that you can see on YouTube over Cabbage Patch dolls in the malls in Canada and in other places, because people were so intent thinking that it was all about this. And if I could just get this, I would have everything that I needed. And they sacrificed their own morals to do it. We don't have to do that. And God can send a rich supply to you over this Christmas season as you make him the Lord of your life. So make sure you're properly dressed going out this Christmas season. Yeah, you know, wear your winter boots. If there's going to be a wind chill factor, make sure you got a proper jacket and a hat on and mitts and all that stuff. But underneath that, make sure that Jesus can be seen. Again, not just in a hidden way, you know, I go to church on Sundays, but display him everywhere you go. Show people grace. Show people mercy, the same mercy that you've received. Give it away to other people. Be open to not just be looking to fulfill the Christmas list of purchases you need to get, but know that there are people that God's put on your list and have eyes for them. Look for the needs of others. And then look for how Jesus, through you, wants to meet someone over this Christmas season. It's as simple as just stopping and thinking about it, honestly, before you get on to the next task. So don't be in a rush this Christmas season. I know there's going to be lots of stuff that you got to get done and lots of tasks to complete and maybe lots of prep. All that stuff is great, but make sure that your heart is prepared for the season and the people that you're going to meet. God bless you. Take some time to meditate on that verse. I hope it's going to be a blessing to you and something that's actually going to become a relief for you over this holiday season. And hopefully you, through this, can be the answer to someone who's in real need to meet Jesus over this Christmas season. God bless you.